worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior.
Friends, sati does not mean mindfulness, since mind is not full of anything, really. Rather, it is distilled into a precise, unique, one-pointed focus. Therefore, sati is much better translated as awareness or presence, which is one of the five spiritual abilities and powers. Indriya Bala, one of the seven factors of enlightenment, Buyanga, and the seven methods of a noble eightfold way, Magga. It is, in the widest sense, one of those mental factors inseparably associated with all karmically advantageous, lofty, and beautiful kinds of consciousness. It is continuously established by the method, the core method called the Four Foundations of Awareness, Satipatthana. In the Noble Eightfold Way, it is called Sammasati, right awareness. And the characterization of right awareness goes like this. Awareness of wrong view or right view being present right now is right awareness. Awareness of wrong motivation or right motivation is right awareness. Awareness of wrong speech or right speech right now is right awareness. Awareness of wrong action or right action done right now is right awareness. Awareness of wrong livelihood or right livelihood is right awareness. Awareness of wrong effort or right effort at this very moment is right awareness. Awareness of wrong awareness or right awareness is right awareness. Awareness of wrong concentration or right concentration just now is right awareness. In this way does the path factor, right awareness, work together with, inseparably joined with, associated with, working in parallel and sequence with, simultaneously, all the other seven path factors of the Noble Eightfold Way, Arya Magga. Thank you.
Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air, number 96, recorded late April 2018. There are three questions, two announcements, but usually comes the classic orthodox intro, like this. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. To those who are not yet member of or have not resubscribed to the Buddha Direct group, please subscribe so you get your ticket to Nirvana planted right here and in your email box twice a week. I'll give the link below. It's a Buddha Direct 2 forum on Google's groups. Those who wants to participate in a meditation course here in June 17 to 30 at the Kandy Meditation Center, please send me an email. There are still open seats. The first question, question 285, in what order should we tackle the study of the suttas? First of all, the Buddhist Bible, you can say, or scriptures, the Pratitikvitaka, the canonical text, are approximately 1.5 meter. And the middle half meter, or something like 70 centimeter, is the Sutta-Pitaka, the basket of threads or speeches or sutta, something that streams. Sutta means hearing and streaming. So the streams of information. The first one is the Vinaya-Pitaka, first basket of text, Tripitaka, the three baskets of text. The first basket is the monastic discipline. Lay people doesn't need to, it's basically Jura, six volumes. The last part is the Abhidhamma, the higher science of early Buddhism. Lay people doesn't need to read that, and neither do monastics if they are not specialists, but all should read the middle third. And the middle third contains these 15 books I will go through here. In what order? I think the most natural order is to take it in the order they were arranged at the first Buddhist council 6 months after Buddha's death. There it was recited in a special order, and this recital, which has taken place regularly, the last time in 1956 is in Burma, the Jatasangayana, where all Buddhist monks meet and then decides what's the correct text, but basically has not changed for many centuries actually. Especially not these texts I'm going to tell you about today, they have not changed. Not even a comma, I would say. Some endings, but it's very, very, very little. When you look at the corrections. The corrections are usually given in the Pali source texts, what all the editions have. And when you see the corrections, there will be something like 2, 3, 4, 5 corrections per page. Usually comma or grammatical endings. Usually not something that has a bearing on the meaning of the text at all. First comes the Digha Nikaya, the long collection. This is the 31, it's this volume. I'll show the pictures up here, and there is a picture of them. Frontispiece of the pictures of the modern, most modern translation. The most modern is the Digha Nikaya by Maurice Walsh, so far. There's also several public translations on the internet. I'll give the links below on whatbuddhasaid.net, on access to insight. And the last site is called Sutta Central. Which is fairly comprehensive, actually, where it's also in English translation, Chinese, Japanese, a whole lot of French translation, German translation, a whole lot of languages. SuttaCentral.net, which I think will be the place in the future. But first of all, is Digha Nikaya, the 31 long speeches of the Buddha. They are from 35 to 50 to 70 pages each. We will discuss one of them, the Sutta explaining the beginnings, basically the Genesis book in Buddhism, about evolution of the planet Earth and human beings and so on. Then it comes to Majjhima Nikaya, the middle length discourses. There are 152 of those middle length. They are from 5 to 10 to 15 pages each. Then come the Samyutta Nikaya, the grouped discourses. There are 2,889 of those. You see it here. Samyutta Nikaya, the group discourses. Then comes the numerical discourses, Anguttara Nikaya. There are approximately 9,000. There's some disagreement about how many there are, because you can cut them up in alternative ways. They are from usually one page, half a page, one page each. Then comes the Kodaka Nikaya, which is a collection of small texts, but they are actually not that small, actually. The Kutakapata is the short passage, the Dhammapada, which is 427 poems of the Buddha, very popular. I will translate it as the right way, or the way of the Dhamma, very popular, many translations by various people. The Udana, which is exclamations or inspirations. The Itivutaka, this was said, they are kind of like little finger size each. Sutta-Vyata, the collection of threads. Vimanyavattu and Petavattu, stories of the mansions and hungry ghost. This is Mogayana, who thinks, what if I go up to the devas and ask them what actions made them devas? And then he asked the Buddha permission to do that, and then the Buddha said, that's a good idea, please do. And this book is basically what they told him. Then he went down afterwards, down to the hungry ghosts, the petas, and asked them what actions brought them there, downwards. And what they said of the actions that made them hungry ghosts, this is explained in the Petavattu, Stories of the Hungry Ghosts. Then there are Theragatta verses of the elder monks and Therigatta verses of the elder nuns. After enlightenment, also after your enlightenment, after my enlightenment, usually one will say a poem or several of them. And this is usually one suddenly realizes what action or what way one came to enlightenment, finally. And this one will usually realize in a poetic form of 4 lines, 8 lines, so on. Can also be shorter, a little longer than that. And these are what these enlightened monks at the Buddhas and nuns said at their enlightenment time. This is collected in this Therigatta and Theragatta, verses of the elder monks and nuns. There's a similar one in one poem called the Poem of the Rhinoceros Horn of the Pacheka Buddhas, the solitary Buddhas that doesn't teach unless you ask them, that are higher than the that an arahant, normal arahant, that are Pacheka Bodhi, enlightened after the solitary Buddha's way. And they also have said some lines, and they are collected also in the text. I think very, very beautiful. Very short, very precise, ultra general. Then comes the Jataka stories, which is the 447 previous rebirth stories of Gautama Buddha, where both when he was a divine being, when he was a human being, and when he was an animal. This is this, what he told himself about his prior lives, usually at various occasions, where there was a suitable event that kind of like stimulated him telling about it. Then there's Nidesa. This is not yet translated, this explanation and the commentary to parts of the Sutta Nipatta. Then there's a Patita Sambhita Magga, which is the passive discrimination, which is the closest you come to the Abhidhamma, the higher science, which is a series of treatises by Sariputta, the right-hand disciple of the Buddha, the Akasakavaka. All Buddhas have two main disciples, and Sariputta, son of Sari, was one of Gautama Buddha's disciples. He's called the general of the Dhamma, not for nothing. And when the Buddha, he conceived and told about, not conceived about, but told about to his mother as his present to her for being her mother, a thanks, kind of thanksgiving. And the next, two levels up, then every afternoon, he told it during a 3 months long, one long speech, which lasted 3 months. And this can only be given to divine beings, because human beings cannot sit still and listen for 3 months. They have to go to the toilet and eat and sleep and so on. But devas can. And so every afternoon he would place an emanation up there, keep speaking, and then his physical body will go down to Lake Anuttata, where Sariputta would wait him with a bowl full of food. And then while he was eating his food, washing his fingers, he will tell Sariputta, so and so much has been told today. This was the headings, this was the details, this was the explanations. And from that, the Abhidhamma was recited by Sariputta to his pupils. And Sariputta then kind of like made a commentary, ultra short commentary, and that is the path of discrimination. A difficult but very, very rewarding text, very rewarding. It took me almost 2 years to come through it, even though it's a book of this size. Then, after that, is Apadana, is past life experiences by the Buddhas, the Pachika Buddhas, and the awakened monks and elderly nuns. Then comes the Buddha Vamsa, which is the chronicle of the Buddha Gautama, and the 24 Buddhas before him. Their life stories after a certain scheme, where they were born, what their mother and father, who their mother and father was, how tall they were, how did they look, what they eat, and so on. The name of their wife, their horse, their waiter, and so on. Going through a very minute schedule for all 24 Buddhas that was before Buddha Gautama, and then also Buddha Gautama himself. Buddha Vamsa, the chronicle of the former Buddhas. Then comes, last one comes is the Kariya Pitaka, which is the baskets of doings or actions, which Buddha, he explained about how he perfected the 10 perfections, the Dasa Parami, which starts with generosity, how he perfected them to the third degree during his many, many lives. From he decided to become a Buddha, these 24 Buddhas ago, first one he gave his Buddha woe, his Bodhisattva woe to was Dipankara, another Buddha. And then through all these ages, all these universal cycles, how many we don't know exactly, but it's more than 150, probably more than 1,000, until he arrives here at planet Earth as a fully enlightened Sammasambuddha. These texts are available both in book form and now also freely available. I think it's most best to have in book, because a book you can bring to it. But if you have a tablet or can read on a tablet or whatever you can read out, people read on their phone. But it depends about what you're used to. I'm most used to books, but they are kind of like old school now. But otherwise, they are freely available on my website, which is whatbuddhasaid.net. Many of these texts, not all of them, but many of them, on accesstoinsight.org. And then also, as I said, the suttacentral.net, which is a new Australian maintained site. So far, so good. These texts, I recommend this 75 centimeters of text. I recommend that you read three times before you die. If you can do that, then I can almost, and act accordingly, then I can almost guarantee you a divine rebirth, if you are not too polluted from past actions. I cannot say it in a general sense, but anyone who do that will have a fair chance, more than a fair chance. We are in the more than 50%. So this is just jacking it up, because gradually doing the study, one will become perfumed and lifted up, elevated and purified by the text itself. And it's difficult to read so much text without starting to purify yourself, because you become inspired by it, obviously. As I hope also you become inspired by these videos. Basically, what is the inspiration? Is it the Buddha? No, it's the Dhamma. It's the truth of the Dhamma. This very deep, highly generalizable, ultra meta level information that can be used in a variety of situations, that goes for all beings and for all times, and that is absolute. It is that is the inspiration that inspires me and inspires you, if the Dhamma is transmitted through the Buddhas, through his pupils, and then out in the society without loss or pollution. Then this is the ideal case, because then the inspiration, the mark they set in the mind, and thereby purifying the mind, changing the mind to behave in another way, and thereby getting another karmic future, inducing another future for that particular being and that particular society in which this being is living in and participating in. Then that's the ideal case. Huh? So there, I think, we are a lot of people and have been a lot. That's basically the duty of the Sangha, is to keep the Dhamma pure. In the ideal case, without any alterations whatsoever since the promulgation from the last Sammasambuddha. So whatever he said should not be changed at all. The meaning of it should not be changed at all, because it is already utterly perfect. If you try to change something that is perfect, then it becomes non-perfect, because you cannot make something that is perfect more perfect. It is already ultimate. So the perfect is perfect. Don't change the perfect, then it will decay. So much for the text of the Buddha. In general, cut very short, read the Sutta Pitaka from the start. Digha Nikaya first, green book, 34 speeches of the Buddha. and then go through it from the start to the end, three times, before you take your last breath, then it is very good. And you will benefit from it for a long, long, long time forward. More than 1,000 existences. More than 1,000,000 years. Question 286. What is conceptual thinking and how can we erode it? Yeah, first, what is conceptual thinking? There's been one concept digged out of Pali by a very good scholar monk here, Venerable Katukurunde, Nyanananda Thera. He wrote an essay. He started as a Pali scholar at Peradeniya University, which you see here, I think probably the most beautiful university in the world, but I have not seen all. And then after being lecturing there, assistant lecturer there, he became a monk. And then he wrote an essay, I think brilliant essay, which is called Concept and Reality. I'll give the link below. It's free as a PDF file on my website. And there he translated for the first time Papanca into English as conceptual proliferation. And that was a genius step forward for Pali scholarship and for Buddhism in general, because that's exactly what it is. So language is a virus from outer space, have somebody said, and there's something truth to it. Why so? Because language expresses reality. For example, we have the voices of the birds. You form the concept bird. This is a small animal that can fly, usually, not except penguins and so on. It has feathers. But then conceptual birds, there's more than one kind of birds. There's this bird, that bird, that bird. This is a proliferation because then one names each bird for itself. And so after birds come, there's subspecies of birds, of these kinds of birds. There's many kinds of does. There are pearl does, mountain does, rock does, and so on. So this is an inevitable consequence of thinking and naming. This name and form, which is basically this activity of naming, keep naming. It keeps finding differences and subdivide the differences and subdivide. Each time it subdivides, proliferates, basically, and thereby forms a new concept. It puts a new name on it. So this model, linguistic language model of reality, one has inside the head, which is expressed in concept and languages, which one tends to fall in love with as an accurate representation of what is out there, which is, it is never so, never so. This is basically built out of building blocks, out of bricks, and these bricks are concepts, panyati, small knowledges. Panya, knowledge, understanding, wisdom. Panya, the diminutive, small knowings. Not big knowings, unfortunately. Then, what if you have a ton of small knowings? Doesn't they make a big knowing? No, unfortunately not. Why not? Because then you become confused. There's too many trees in the forest. You cannot see the forest because of all these trees. There's so many sand cones on the beach, you cannot see the ocean. So the mind becomes confused if the conceptual proliferation, the conceptual thinking, papancha, thinking this and that and this and that and this and that and further on, one thought leads to the next one and next one and next one, subdividing, subdividing, analyzing, analyzing. So he made this, I think, very good thing. I can recommend to read this essay. Again, I give the link below here as a PDF. Bhikkhu, Katukurunde, Nanananda Thera, Concept of Reality. Dig that. Conceptual thinking is called vitakka vichara. This ceases in the second jhana. Beyond conceptual thinking, the non-conceptual, non-thinking is attaka avacara. It's a very interesting state of consciousness where conceptual thinking has ceased. There's no thinking. There's still perception, but there's no thinking. You still understand, but you don't think. And this points to that this understanding, this knowing, can go beyond knowing names. Because knowing names and relation between names, that is conventional knowledge. But supermundane knowledge is knowing what the names are naming, what they are covering over, and how all this relates to each other, what it is on the meta level. It doesn't so much go around dotting the details on the beach, counting the sand corns on the beach. That's conceptual thinking. Basically, it's stamp collection, you would say from an academic point with a slightly derogative expression. If an academic says about another academic discipline that is stamp collection, then he means that it's just stacking up details, like stamp you have in a stamp collection. But it's not doing anything else than that. It's basically archiving concepts, archiving details, but not explaining how all these details are connected, where they come from, where they are going, what their causes is, what their effects are. It doesn't explain that. So it's stamp collection, not regarded as true science. Nevertheless, how do we erode that? Yes, the classic way of doing away with this conceptual churning, this conceptual thinking of the mind, on all these innumerable, infinite number of details and level of details and relation between all these details. The way to cease this, to still this, to silence this ever-churning of the mind is anapanasati, breathing meditation. When anapanasati, breathing meditation, first gradually cease the thinking by fooling it to staying only on the breath touch in the nostrils, then it can go through what we call the nine stillings. They still what? In the first meditative jhana, the first absorption, all sense desire ceases. So one doesn't want to sense anything, taste anything, touch anything. One doesn't even want to think anything. In the second jhana absorption, all conceptual thinking ceases. That's here. Boom. Then it's gone. Then the calm is perceived as almost semi-solid. I mean that the calm is like such, if I should explain it in imaginary terms, then it could be like you are inside a very, very large room, like a cathedral. And inside this large room could be emptiness, that like empty air, for example. But this is not, even though there's no sound at all, there's completely silence inside there, but there's still air and light. Let's say you take the air out and then replace it with a kind like hot butter, a semi-fluid thing. One can almost cut in it, like butter standing on the table, not in the fridge, but on the table on a midday. Then you can take your knife and cut it in. It's semi-fluid. It is not fluid. It is not solid. It is in between solid and fluid. Your perception of mental calm, of this ceasing of all perceptual thinking, is like that. It is semi-solid. It is almost like one can touch it with the mind. So still is it. Very pleasant. In the third jhana, joy, enraptured joy, ceases. In the fourth jhana, breathing in and out ceasing. Breathing ceases. One can spend 7 days in this meditative absorption. How come it's a kind of hibernation? One has very low metabolism. One burns basically the oxygen that are in the muscles, stored in the muscles, in the myoglobin, not erythroglobin, but myoglobin, what makes the muscles red. The oxygen storage is there. One will have a pulse around something like 20, 10 to 20, just like certain reptiles, when they die, they have the same pulse and same very, very low metabolism. Or just like bears that hibernate in caves during the winter time. Very low metabolism, but not dead. Stilled, but not dead. I'll give the link below between the difference of being dead and being stilled. So the Buddha talked about that. In the sphere of infinite space, the experience of form and sensory action ceases. In the sphere or jhana of infinite consciousness, the experience of infinite space ceases. In the sphere of nothingness, the experience of infinite consciousness ceases. The infinitude of consciousness ceases. In the sphere of neither perception nor non-perception, nothingness, even nothingness, emptiness, voidness ceases. When attaining complete mental cessation, all perception and sensation ceases. This is the nine stillings. These nine sublime states has been perfectly formulated by the blessed Buddha, who knew and saw directly. Therefore, we should recite them together for the future advantage, welfare, and happiness of both human beings and devas. This hereby be done. The nine stillings. Ladies and gentlemen, the nine stillings. And they are explained in the link that passed below here at whatbuddhasaid.net. Now comes some of the heavy shooting. Question 287. What is the evolution genesis of human beings in Buddhism? This is explained in Digha Nikaya number 27. We have discussed it before. The long discourses number 27, the Agganna Sutta, on the beginnings, the origins of the world. There's two free translations and one book translations. Two book translations actually. I'll give the link below this video. Basically, what the Buddha told two Brahmins about the beginnings of the world was that after the Big Bang, when the world has contracted and become a very hot singularity, which only happens up to a certain Brahma level. So we are level 5, but above level 16, doesn't go into this conflation. So, and this is, I think, an important message to those who are physicists. And especially the cosmologist, there are always observers observing the universe. So the anthropological or anthropocentric principle cannot be rejected on the assumption that before the world started there are no observers. That's not the case. There are plenty of observers, always, in between the Big Bang and the Big Crunch in the next Big Bang. Our goals are as far as saying that these observers are creative and conditioning in forming the details of the next evolution after the Big Bang. So please pay attention to that, those who are physicists and cosmologists. The no observer argument doesn't hold because there are observers. So he says that they fall from a Brahma level when they have exhausted their karma, basically burned up the probability, then forced to the next level, and next level, and next level, level. This takes an unspecified number of million years. I would say, if we take the age of planet Earth, let's say 5 billion years. Earth is 4.7 billion years. Huh? So could take something less, let's say 2 billion years, for them to fall down. Then they see the Earth and like to taste it, what's on the surface of the Earth, which is described to be almost a fluid. And then gradually they lose the ability to fly. And they get intestines over many generations. Huh? And then they end up eating funguses that was among the first plant life here on planet Earth. And then afterwards rice and so on, but took many billion years. is evolution. So it's a kind of reverse Darwinism. Reverse Darwinism. In what way do I reject Darwinism? No, I do not reject Darwinism for plants and for all non-conscious live beings, like protozoa, parasites, unicellular beings. Darwinism pretty well explains how they are diversified. But you can see kind of like, okay, this is a biological level, but what about the beings that have no body? When they fall down and start to eat what this level of live beings that has no consciousness, then suddenly a layer between beings that has no body and biological life without a consciousness, this become unified. And there both Darwinism and the law of karma plays in, because what body they will get down at the biological level depends upon their behavior, depends upon their karmic accumulation. And this then follows them forever hereafter. And this goes for all beings that has consciousness, including animals, down to multicellular life, around, let's say, 200 cells or something like that, maybe up to a little less than that, a little more than that, but in the order of hundreds of cells, consciousness can embed itself. This tree behind me and most of these plants can have billions of cells. There are many plants that have an amount of DNA that is 100 times the amount of DNA that we have. And thereby they embed a humongous amount of genetic information. So it has nothing to do with biological complexity. It is just so that there are certain biological beings that can support consciousness. I think it has something to do with mobility. And then there are some that they cannot support consciousness. Consciousness itself is very non-local and very mobile, so it makes sense that it kind of like enfolds itself on something that is mobile also. And it does that in a way that it will get the same amount of degrees of freedom that it has, that it behaved on this layer. When it falls down or go upwards, then it would get the amount of degrees of freedom it has deserved, or it has earned up, it has accumulated. And this means that it will choose out many different biological beings, from ant to worm to human being to eagle and so on, and to the various kinds of devas, which also has form. Some of them also biological form, but not all. Most of them physical form, but even some of them are formless, without form, without conjunction with any kind of physical matter or atoms or forms of energy. And this the Buddha basically explains, and how all the castes goes up. I can recommend this sutta. I repeat again, it is the Digha Nikaya number 27, the Agganna Sutta, and I give the links below. Next level, last question. Why did the Buddha categorize the human plane as of existence as separated from the animal plane? Yes, again, the Buddhist cosmology talks about 31 levels of existence. There's the formless level, there's five formless beings, only consciousness. The fine material level, from level 12 to 27. And then there's the lower 11 levels, which is the karma loka, where all the beings that run after sense pleasure. Karma, sense pleasure. So they are driven by and determined by their lust, desire, attachment to sense pleasure, which they seek in many variable, diverse forms, from music to fine dinners to sex, drugs and rock and roll and what have you. Anything that can be seen, heard, smelled, tasted, touched or thought of. This is basically sense pleasure. There are two layers of those. There's the happy destinies, that's just the human plane. So this is extraordinarily rare to become a human, extraordinarily. One out of a billion chance, just by random. We say it's a happy place because humans always are happy. No, because humans have a chance, a possibility, the option, so to speak, they can determine them themselves whether they want to go higher and attain higher level of sense pleasure, but also higher level of happiness, even up to the Brahma level. They can determine that by themselves. Animals cannot. They do not have this degree of freedom, this choice. When I say choice, then it's important to understand that everybody, this choice, first of all, it has to be a conscious choice, also called intention. And anyone who can choose intentionally between A and B, they form karma. And thereby, they accumulate future. A specific future according to the specific choices of behavior they do. Advantageous behavior, not greedy, not angry, not ignorant, they get higher degrees of freedom. Detrimental choices, we come into the 10 unwholesome actions later on, lower degrees of freedom. Lower degrees of freedom means asura level 4, one level down. The angry demons or titans, also something called, they engage in relentless conflict. It reminds about the phenomenon of war, which seems there has been no place in my time here on planet Earth that hasn't been several wars, usually more than 5 to 10 are going on simultaneously. And there is also today, there's also several wars. At least one in Syria, a very gray one, and then some low burn conflicts various places. Level 3 is the hungry shades or the hungry ghosts, the petaloka. They cannot get anything to eat. Then comes the animals and level 2, Tirakana Yoni. They come there, they all animals from insects to fish to birds to worms because of the 10 unwholesome actions explained in the Majjhima Nikaya number 41, which I'll come into. Those who are end up as animals are usually dominated by wrong view. Ignorance is where they are coming. The petas, the hungry ghosts, are usually desires. Thieves, for example, are very desirous after what they steal. Those who take bribe, those who commit fraud, very greedy. So they end up as hungry ghosts. The angry one, the aggressive ones, the fighters, they end up as asuras, angry demons. Those who kill and do all bad things, they end up in the hells. Of which there is 8 majors with 16 minors around, which means there is 136 hells in all, also explained by the Buddha. All these lower degrees of freedom are obtained by these 10 unwholesome or detrimental akusala forms of behavior, which is 1, killing, destroying life, you destroy yourself. 2, stealing, taking what is not given, you will lose everything. 3, sexual abuse, adultery, pedophilia mainly. 4, false speech, lying. 5, slanderous speech, gossiping about others. 5, there's for 5 standard speech. 6, harsh speech, scolding. 7, idle chatter, empty chatter on the internet, blah, blah, blah. 8, covetousness, lust, desire, envy. 8, ill will, anger, aggression, opposition. And 10, wrong view, I know better attitude, which is very, very common. Very, very common. And also a wrong view about how reality works. Explained in this most hardcore form, like, there are no recluses, there are no monks, there are no obligations to mother and father, they don't do good. There's no good action, there's no bad action. You can do whatever you like. It doesn't affect your future. There's only this world, there's no other world. There's no life after death. And first of all, what the monks and priests says that are pure, that has experienced these other worlds by their own direct experience, what they explain is not correct, because I know better. This is wrong view. This is enough in itself, the Buddha says, to have a bad destiny. Thank you for your advantageous attention, clever consideration, and kind contribution. Thank you in particular to the food donors. There's somebody who give every month, and that's why me and the cat and the dog is still alive. Thank you also to those who give every month something to make the wheels rolling and the videos coming. There are many. I get something like 2 or 3, sometimes 5 thank you letters every day. And I'm very, very happy about to know that this is coming out there and make a difference for some, I think, fairly high-level beings. And thank you also to those who donate to the meditation hall, the ultimate instrument of awakening, the tool to enlightenment. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. And may you indeed have a nice and noble day. Thank you.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparella, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.